Yes, right. I assume that everybody is, motivated to develop global academic portfolio. All right, so that, there are many purposes for the academic portfolio, but I think having the teachers start their own portfolio for any purposes, right? Okay, so that's me. Okay, my name is Azidah from University Sains Malaysia. So I use a lot of technology tools. That doesn't mean that you have to use a lot of technology tools. That's me. You might have different destinies, different interests, and so on. So you can follow whatever others are doing, but try to follow what you like, what your interests are, then you can know your path. Alright? Alright. So let me see. I think I will be able to send the volume as a same as so I think Azidah Pro has firewalls. Okay, so just type https://azidah.com/um11110. And then the
Alright. Okay, so this is the module.
okay? And while you are listening to my explanation on the slide, so please just your about me here, right? Under this, under about me, just click plus, and then put a photo of you, and then put about why I need you all to be about me, because this is the beginning of your portfolio. So introduce yourself as an academic, alright? And as how you want people to know you. Alright, later on you are going to copy that and put it in your portfolio. Alright? So just click here. This one. And click that. And then you have been using Telegram before, right? Okay, it's okay. We took two times and we have been using that before. Alright, okay. Yes. Put your link there. Alright, and then you upload your photo and see if you know. If you upload the photo, then you can immediately take photo. Upload this. The left one. While you are waiting, you can join this dancer.
Select the content of your portfolio.
Alright, so I don't know anything about you except Dr. Zahir. I know a little bit about you. Not so much. but other than that, I don't know you and I don't know which area are you from, okay, what's your expertise and so on. So you know about yourself. So to me, you are moving to develop something about you so that you can publish or you can portray to people outside the end. Okay? Alright, and then I'm going to guide you on how to create your academic portfolio. Alright, so today is your first day in embarking on the academic portfolio, but it won't finish here today. Alright, this is just the beginning. Afterwards, you have to gradually develop your portfolio so that it will be much more comprehensive. Okay? And then I hope that today we enrich all of you in terms of identifying. You need to identify, okay, the content of your academic portfolio. What is the much important event that you have encountered since the first day you embark on being an academic? Alright, so can you remember the first day you become a teacher? Okay, I consider us, we all as a teacher. Alright, so when was the first time that you become a teacher, an educator? Alright, so remember the first day you come and enter a program, for example, if, let's say UM is your first place that you become a lecturer. Okay, so if you have been teaching somewhere else, then what happens with your first day when you become a teacher, an educator? Alright, so you need to try to remember what happened on your first day, and then for example, if you have been for 10 years, what has been happening during the 10 years of your teaching? It is all yours. Okay, all yours. I'm just guiding you today so that you can make the story of what you have experienced in the academic life. Okay? Alright, so what is a portfolio? If you can see in the left side, alright? That is my CV. Is portfolio a CV? Yes or no? You think? Yes, more elaborated. Okay, you were going to mention this. Alright, so it is not just a CV. CV is like 5% or maybe 0.15%. Of your portfolio. It is easy. CV is easy. You just put everything, you compile everything, whatever, and then it becomes a one piece of CV or two pieces of CV. Alright? But a portfolio is beyond that. Okay, it's beyond that. Okay, so when I was, I did my degree, my first degree in graphic design and multimedia. Alright, so it was actually arts based in that I learned how to draw first in my first years, and I do live drawings. You know what's a live drawing? Alright, live drawing when we have to draw people sometimes, you know. I did my degree, my first degree in the UK. So what happened was during the like probably we have people, the model come to a place whereby sometimes they have to open all their clothes, you know, be a model in front of us, and then we have to draw them, alright, live, okay. So that was the first part actually for us, you know, my school. I was not married yet, okay, a very young lady, and it was like, oh my god, I have to draw him. Okay, so that was the experience from the arts person, alright? I am an art person. So I draw, I do it, alright? Then we are done drawing. And then after we have drawn, we have to keep our artworks and so on, we have to put it in a portfolio bag. Alright, portfolio bag. At that time, we have to buy a big portfolio bag, E2 size. Alright, so you know in A4 size, E3 size, but we had E2 size and sometimes E1 size. Okay, and then we have to bring that to interviews and so on to get a job. Alright, so that was how we see portfolio at that time. Alright, so whatever creative work that we have done, we put it in the portfolio bag. And then we take it to the employer, and then we look for jobs, and we went through our portfolio bags, whatever the code that we have, and then we evaluate that, right? It's the evaluation process, okay? However, what is a PG portfolio, right? Fundamentally, it is quite similar to what I have done during my degree. Okay, I have that big E2 artist portfolio, alright? So, it is assembly, alright? Of the breadth and depth, okay? Of an artist's work, okay? So, to display their abilities, strength and stuff. So, for teaching portfolio, it will portray, your teaching portfolio will portray your abilities. First, what are your abilities? Only you know that. I don't know. So, today we are going to have a lot of thinking. You are going to look at yourself and think, what are my abilities? Okay? And then my strength. Okay? My strength. So, what are your strengths in your academic life? Okay? What do you think? In your class, what did you do in your research? Okay, so why your style of teaching? Okay, every people have different style of teaching. So what do you do when you enter a classroom? Okay, so I don't know what you do in your class, but you will know, and also your students will know. Alright. So, Dr. Sari told that I am called Martin. Martin is the stepmother. Stepmother by my students and the new lecturers of USM. They call me Martin. Okay, I am quite, I'm firm in my decision. Okay, I'm quite garang. Garang, think that, you know, always scolded my students as well as the new lecturers, because we keep them 2 weeks. Teaching and learning course for the new lecturers, and then we have to do this portfolio. Okay, it is a compulsory in USM. It is compulsory for all the new lecturers to produce a portfolio before they confirm. Okay, in their position in USM. If they don't produce the portfolio, then they are not going to have the confirmation for their lecture, okay, before being a lecturer, okay. So what I did in USM, because you know they have like 3 years, okay, to confirm, so they have to finish by around 2 years of their portfolio. Alright, there are certain criteria that they need to meet for the portfolio, but sometimes they are busy and then they forget about their portfolio. So I have to push that. If not, you are not going to confirm. And then if their portfolio is not complete, then they have to redo. They have to redo until they have a complete portfolio. Alright, so I am the one who always push them and so on. So that's why they call me Mati. Because you know, sometimes I become very angry. I already told you that, you know, your interview will be interview for confirmation will be in 2 weeks time, but you haven't finished your portfolio, then so that's why they were like, okay, continue my things, that is the purpose lah. So now why I don't know about my in you at EISM?
Good practice.
Yes, definitely. It happens to me when I did my EEM portfolio. It was in 2015 when I start develop my portfolio. Alright. At that time, okay, there's no candidate from USM for EEM. Alright. So when my boss Prof asked me, but Azidah, you need to join the EEM as a donor. At that time, I was only 7 years in USM, but I have been teaching a polytechnic in Johor Bahru for 3.5 years. So I was like, okay, am I eligible to be in the AM? But when I checked the criteria, yes, I was eligible. So it was around 10 years at that time. But during my teaching in the polytechnic, you know, it was like 1999, there were no handholds, you know. We have handholds, the Dapa one, Motorola, very big. If you put in your handbag, it will be like very heavy. Alright, so no picture taken by the handhold, only SMS. Alright, and then you don't have many pictures, many photos. Alright, because it is expensive to go to the photo shop and, you know, develop your photos. So no evidence, less evidence. Alright, so but I have to do the portfolio for AAN. It was the you know, arahan from USM, so I have to do it. So I found that, you know, starting your portfolio early is very important. Alright, although you don't know what you are going to do with the portfolio, but please do start your portfolio. You might need that later on. Okay, maybe in UN, I remember before COVID, this is my first time coming back to UN after COVID. Alright, but before that, I've been here for, I think, many times. Okay, doing the portfolio as well. And then some of the lecturers come and brought their teaching track portfolio. Alright, for their promotion. And then they ask you to have a look at you. So some of you already developed their portfolio, but from my experience, I found that whatever they have done, only they just collect. They just collected all the evidences, their certificates, their whatever they have done, right, without elaboration on what they have done. Only the evidences. That is what most of us are doing. Okay. That's also something to, you know, you have to do more than just collect. But now, how many years have you been teaching?
2000,
so it's 23 years. 23 years. Alright, it's okay. 2000 is not that bad. But because hopefully you are not going to put everything that you have done since 2000. Alright, so you are going to select, you are going to select, and then you are going to elaborate what you have been doing. But I think it might be a little bit difficult, but you know, because you have experienced it, if you start now, it is not that you know, late for you to start the portfolio. So don't worry about that. Alright, so for teaching portfolio, unlike IT's portfolio, the main body of your portfolio will guide and inform readers, okay, to go through what you have done in your teaching. It is just sample of your teaching, not everything. Every important part of your teaching should be included in your portfolio. Alright? Whatever important parts, okay? And not necessarily you are going to put all your successful story in your portfolio. You might want to put what your unsuccessful, the challenges that you might have during your teaching and so on. It is very important for you to put the challenges. Alright, because that's where people see how you grow as an academic. So jangan letak yang indah-indah saja. Alright? Not too much of the very brilliant you, but you know, because everybody have their own obstacle, right? Okay, so put everything that is important. Okay, in my portfolio, right? In my portfolio, I did mention about when I taught in the polytechnic. Okay, I start teaching in the polytechnic after I graduated with my master's. Alright? So, at that time, I have no idea what teaching is all about. So, whatever I did in my classroom was based on the experience me as a student. Whatever my lecturers had done in the classroom, I did to my students. So, my lecturers, because we learn art, so whatever, you know, when we our artwork was not good and so on, you know, our lecturers will always like, oh yeah, kind. They throw away our, okay, this is bad. They throw away our artwork. So, I also did the same to my student. Alright? When I teach in polytechnic, I teach diploma in graphic design. So, when their artwork was not good, I just hear it, thought, and then throw it away. Sometimes, you know, I ask them to redo and so on. Alright? So, that experience I put in my portfolio. Alright? I put it in my portfolio because, okay, that is actually looking at my teaching philosophy at that time. As teachers, we should have a teaching philosophy. This is a very, the main important part in your portfolio as an academic. Because your philosophy will actually be implemented, okay, in your class. So, although now you might not know what is your teaching philosophy, but actually you have it in your heart, in your mind. For example, if you go to your class, alright, dah lama dah you have been teaching online. So this semester we are going back to face-to-face. So what you are going to do in your class? Okay, can you tell me what you are going to do in your class? The first class in this semester.
I want to introduce myself first.
Okay.
Also, I want a brief introduction from my students as well, because they are returning to classroom and physical classes after a long time. I want to make sure that I can do that please. I will start with the topic that will introduce the course, and also I will try to focus on the first topic of the syllabus because the lecture is 3 hours, so I think I can cover all those things.
Alright, so you said that you are going to introduce yourself.
Yeah.
How are you going to introduce yourself?
Usually I do not give a very elaborate introduction to my students. I just tell them my name, my designation, and that's all. I do not say much.
Okay, alright. So, okay, how would you introduce yourself differently? If let's say your first class later on, okay, how would you introduce yourself differently?
One time I did one small video showing the work that we did in Philippines. And then did introduction on the subject and also my students. After the activity, introduced myself and show me that what work has been done and what they can learn from me.
That is, you know, how you can introduce yourself differently. I think you mean that you put that to my first slide. This is how I start with the presentation. I show myself with lots of technology tools because I teach educational technology. Right? I teach ICT. So when I start my class, I always show this because I would like my students to know that they are going to explore different technology. They might go beyond this technology that I showed here. Alright, so this is the way we portray ourselves to the students. And for your portfolio, you might want to portray yourself differently from others. Okay. I remember in EAN, I saw people submitted, and EAN is under academic negara, I saw people submitted the EAN in a box with so many things inside the box. Alright, I don't know how they said it. Last time they used the hypothesis. I was like, if I were the evaluator of the portfolio, I might not want to see that because it's too much. Alright, so when you try to develop your portfolio, academic portfolio, please make sure that it is not too much for people, okay, not exhausting. Okay, the people will be like, oh, I don't want to make this anymore. Okay, not too much, but you portray whatever you need to tell people. Alright, the most important part in your academic career that will help students, that helps students to grow. Alright, so that is the most important part. So, yeah. So meaning that you will get people to what you are doing, you are currently doing, and what you have done, and what you plan to do next after this. Okay, for example, if you have achieved certain achievement, so what you are going to do next? Are you going to stop there? Alright, so that is what you are doing throughout your academic career. I think 22 years is still long. You have so many very comprehensive experience, alright? But how you compile it is very important. Okay. Alright. So, thinking of you, document your experience. It is based on your experience as a teacher or instructor throughout your career. Okay, some people, they would like to add their PhD, their master's experience in their portfolio, because maybe there is something important from that particular experience. So you need to decide whether you want to start from the first day to become a teacher, or if you want to start from your PhD, or you were a student and so on. It's up to you. It is your portfolio, right? Okay, for me, I start my portfolio with an introduction. But introduction lead people to who I am, why I become an educator. So my story in my portfolio was, okay, when I was 12 years old. Okay, 12 years old, my mom, okay, she taught young, my friends, okay, my friends' children, Al-Quran. Okay, she taught. My mama was my late mom was a housewife. So in her free time, she taught children to read the Quran. So when there are many children come to our house, and then she told me, can you help me teach the student, the children to read Al-Quran as well? So I started being a teacher when I was 12 years old. I taught the children how to read the Quran, and then when I see them, they can read the Quran, I was very happy, and then I said, oh, I am a good teacher. Alright, I think that I am a good teacher, and then my ambition was to be a teacher, because I know I have the ability to become a teacher. Okay, that was my introduction to my portfolio. Introduction, because I would like people to know where I start being a teacher. Alright, so some people might say, okay, during my, when I was waiting for SPM, for example, I become a vision teacher, and then during my secondary school, I always taught my friends in mathematics. So I know that my friends will be able to understand the mathematics more when they learn from me compared to when they learn from my teachers. So that motivated me to become a teacher. Alright? Your portfolio should start with something that inspires you. or why? Or maybe because, you know, you have been working as, for example, you work in a bank, for example. But then, you know, sometimes you read a newspaper, there is an advertisement, or to be a temporary teacher, for example, and then you say, why not? I try. Maybe something like that, you know, that is a story that triggered you to become a teacher or an academic. Alright? So, yeah, so that is the introduction whereby you document your experience from the beginning. What triggered you to be an academic? Alright? And then, oh, however, it is not just story. Okay, you can tell people anything, but without any evidence, okay, without evidence, then it's just a story. So you need to provide concrete evidence of your effectiveness of the teacher. Okay, kalau dia teacher itu, if you become a teacher but nobody likes you, then, you know, you've got your end of semester evaluation, you got all, like less than 50%, so you know you are not effective teachers. So you need to have some evidences that you are actually an effective teacher. Alright, and then it will help you to track your progress, okay, as you improve and develop your skills as an individual. So actually, when you develop your academic portfolio, mainly because of yourself. Okay? Because of yourself. If you don't write, okay? For example, yeah, suddenly you have one whole class, they don't understand what you are teaching. Alright? So then you say, maybe the students, they are all lazy. Okay, they are all lazy, that's why they don't understand what I'm teaching, for example. Alright? So you don't, if you, your answer is like that, okay, you don't reflect to yourself as a teacher. What do I do wrongly, okay? What have I done in my class so that everybody don't understand what I'm teaching? Alright? So you need to reflect yourself. So teaching portfolio is a way for us as a teacher to reflect ourselves. Apa saya buat dalam kelas saya? Okay, what did I do in my class? Okay, what happened in my class? Do I go to the 3-hour class and I give lectures all the time? Okay, do I think that my students will all listen and then they will be able to focus for 3 hours lecture? Okay, so you know that is the reflection that you should have done. And the reflection should be included in your portfolio. Alright? So, why should you have, I already have a degree portfolio, so I'm asking you, why do you think, why you should have a degree portfolio? Why should you have a degree portfolio?
One of it is from CDAE, but I think it's also good for us to document our journey, so that we know where we come from, and then what our progress along the way, and then we know what we want to do.
Okay, alright. I don't know what happened, alright. So I have less evidence to when I would like to develop my portfolio. I got whatever left and then I got net after I moved to net. But when I was asked to do the portfolio, I was like, okay, I have no evidence in the polytechnic. But I need to include that in my portfolio because I am using the 3.5 years experience in polytechnic as part of my EEN application. So I have to have evidences. Alright, I cannot see. Just see, but I need evidence. What happened was I found only one Polaroid photo. Okay, one Polaroid photo. I'll show you the Polaroid photo. They go to my website and the website has Azidah.com. Okay, this is my website www.azidah.com. You can have look at my portfolio AAN. So I'm here, I have the portfolio AAN. Just click that. Alright. And then this is my portfolio. You can have a look, you can click here. Will go to my Google Drive. You can download it if you want. Alright, but it's already using Malay, so those who are Malay can download. Alright. So I have this one evidence. This one. Alright. Okay. This is a collateral photo. Alright. It was taken in polytechnic. Alright, this is me, this was me, this is one of my students, one of my students. Alright, and then I don't know what to do with this photo because it is without, you know, you, I can use it as evidence, but without any description, people just think that this is the photo, it's not evidence. Alright, so I suddenly I just upload in this. What happened was, okay, this is Cikgu Rahim Haji Aziz. This is Rahim. Alright. He put, he commented in the Facebook, Cikgu Rahim, thank you Prof, guru yang baik adalah guru yang garam. He said that the good teacher is a garam teacher, fierce teacher. Okay. Cikgu Rahim said, and then, I kept saying okay, she said she is scared, and then any time was also my student. He said my photo is not there, and then alright, Brandon was my lecturer, So he said in that time saya diajar, he thought he was the only one who was feared. Yes, alright, but he says that I follow him. Okay, and then how is that Sarah said? Hey, Azidah Abu Ziden is actually very garam, very fierce. Alright, I'm scared of her. Alright, so these are the comments from my Facebook from the only one photo that I found. Okay, from my late mom's house. Alright, so all of this, and then as Hakim said, pasal puan garam kami jadi cemerlang. Because you are so fierce, we were excellent. Because you know, I ask them, okay, you need to do this. If you don't do this, then I'm going to find your hour. So we have to do, and then we have to do the best. If not, I'm going to, tear the hour. So because of that, we become excellent. Alright? And that's why I said, okay, she still can remember her artwork being torn. Alright? That is nostalgic, she said. Alright? And then, okay. So meaning that really happened. Meaning that really happened from the one photo that I shared in Facebook. And I just screenshot and I put in my portfolio. This is the evidence that I was really garam lah, I was really fierce during my polytechnic time. Okay, from one photo I can I just upload and I haven't think of anything when I upload that, just you know, because they have been my friend, Facebook friend at that time. So I just upload. Then you know what, Rahim, he after he finished his diploma in polytechnic, he went to the KPLI, the teacher training, certificate of teacher training, and he became teachers. And he teach us just in the school outside USM. But he knows that I've been teaching in USM for many years, but when I asked him, Rahim, don't you want to come to USM and meet me? Then he told me, Dr. Azidah, I'm sorry, I'm still scared of you, so I don't want to go to USM and meet you. I really, really scared. Okay? So, but one time, in 2019, finally he came to see me, like he came to see me, okay, after so many years. Alright? So, this is one of the examples on how you can use your own photo and how you can get evidence of what will during your first year. Maybe it's hard for you to look for evidence, but this, you know, you can be creative in terms of presenting whatever that you have as evidence of on how you teach, for this.
Alright, so for, you know, younger generation, you might want to save everything
think of what you are going to do in your first class differently. Record that, record meaning that if you need to selfie with your student, then go selfie with your student. And then if you need to record whatever, do that so that you have, you know, your evidences for your portfolio. Okay, maybe after you have gone through this thing, you might want to add to your portfolio. I've gone through a portfolio workshop. Okay. The week before the enrollment. So I was thinking that I would like to improve my introduction to the students in my class. So what I did was blah 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 blah. Alright, so you might want to include that in your portfolio. Alright, and then please remember that there is not one perfect way to do a portfolio. Alright, so I cannot say, hey, it is wrong for you to do like that. Okay, it is wrong. A portfolio shouldn't be like that. No, I cannot say that. It is yours and you have to decide what is your portfolio looks like, what your portfolio looks like. Okay. I remember when I my portfolio, alright, you can see here. You can see that actually my portfolio is in landscape, not in portrait. I think it's not like a book, but it's landscape. So in for landscape. So when I was going to submit to USM for EAN, what happened was the creative house director beat back my portfolio to me and said, Azidah, I think you should be good. I said, why? Because you know, everybody is doing their portfolio in portrait info. So you are the only one who are doing it last year. So you know, you need to go there. I said, no, I don't want to redo. It is very hard for me to just redo for the sake of size of the setup. Okay? So I said, no, but he said, no. You need to do that. So I was like, I have designed my own portfolio and you asked me to redo because of maybe printing, hard order to print, right? Because it is different from others. So and then I met my boss, Prof. at that time, but at that time I was not the deputy director yet. So I said to Prof. Can you please help me? Design this in landscape, I have purpose for that and so on, and I like it to be like the still in landscape, not for a portrait. So preparing the road and say, okay, I'll let the other director know that you know you like to do stick on A4 but landscape. So because the board said so that they have to follow that line. So and finally they agreed that my only portfolio in landscape was mine, but I know that there, because you know there is a design of that portfolio. They have a box and have a portfolio. So they provided a box whereby for the portfolio will be like slightly a box. Okay, so when you cut the box, it is different from mine because the opening is different. So that's why they don't want to. The landscape one came back, finally do that, and procuring to me, that is why, you know, the panels, because the procuring was independent as well, they cannot even get mine. So, said, the panel was impressed because your portfolio is different from others. Okay, because they read like this, not like this. So, you know, the portfolio is yours, it is up to you to decide how you would like to portray. But now, you know, you can see people do their portfolio using QR code, they have the virtual reality and so on. So, you, if you have the capability in doing that, why not? They have to just scan your portfolio and then you can see what you have done. Maybe you are doing something in science lab, for example, virtual science lab. So, what you have done in that? So you need to put that in your portfolio. So save everything that you have and then decide it. I think so. The portfolio is an example of your career-related skills and experiences, and should be presented in your own creative style. So be creative. Anybody from arts here? Yang belakang tak yang lain. Are you going to do your portfolio as well? Nanti apa lagi? Buat sekali. So yes. Usually arts people they are. But you know, if you are from anything from sciences, yeah, it's okay. You know, it doesn't mean that down. Okay, but yeah, you can do it as well. Okay. All right. So your portfolio should include the description of your media strength and teaching achievement in a variety of settings. Okay. So. What are your strengths? Do you know what is your strength? What are your strengths? You might have many strengths. What is your strength?
Okay, maybe I can share. One of my strengths is supervising a PhD student with learning communication. So I have 10 PhD students and many of my students. Okay, and she did that from the research department, so from social science. Publishing research is not so easy, not compared to science, medicine or engineering. So my trademark is PhD completed every single with 5 publications. So almost all my PhD students have more than 5 publications, and one student excelled with 5 publications. So this is one of the achievements that I have, and my students I know for communication with
Okay, alright, so that is your strength. Then, okay, you need to also tell people how do you do that. How do you make sure that, how you assist or how you support your students to be able to produce at least 5 publications in high index area. Okay, so that is your strength. And how you achieve your strength also to be included in your portfolio. Alright? Sometimes you know you see that people, a lady for example, she's very soft, okay, soft-spoken and so on, but she achieved many things. Alright? So, it might be because of she is a soft-spoken, people would like people like that, maybe she can deliver what she would like to achieve using her soft spokenness. So maybe something like that. But you are the only, not the only one. You know what is your strength. Okay, for me, my strength is teaching. Alright? And I do a lot of innovation in my class. I teach in a class with many students. Okay, mostly around 400 students per semester. So we teach ICT, alright, computer, apps, and so on for students in 200 students in the class is not easy. Okay? During my first years, they gave me, all my classes were in a computer lab. The computer lab has around 30 computers, alright, but I have to 200 students. Okay, so how many times should I, have in my timetable, to feed the 30 computers in the computer lab? So I have to teach around 7 or 8 hours. Okay, because and I was alone at that time. So that's how the intervention. Because I have to solve my problem. That is research as well. Alright, I have to do something so that I can teach. And then my students can learn, alright? And then, to solve the problem, I need to be very innovative, okay? So, maybe this is your personal strength, okay? You can engage your students, okay? You are very supportive, alright? To inspire your students, example. So you are the only one who knows what is the strength. Or your partner, they might know what is your strength. You ask your wife, ask your husband, they might know. Okay, kalau I tanya my husband, you ask my husband, he will say, cakap lagi sangat. Macam tu lah. Alright? So I speak too fast. My husband will say that, okay, so please speak slowly. That is not my strength, but he knows that, you know, I need to speak slowly. Okay. And then collaborative, you are passionate, and so on. Alright, so you know, and if you don't know, ask your best friend, ask your husband, ask your wife, they will know. Alright, so, and certificates. Alright, you get certificates for whatever. Okay, so maybe you have the teacher of the year, best supervisor, the most popular, we have the most popular lecturer. Okay, voted by students. So if you are popular, every student will know you. Okay, and we can see that every year the same lecturer will go up. Because she knows how, she or he knows how to communicate with students. Okay, like what I had yesterday, students WhatsApp me asking me, doctor, I don't know how to switch off the aircon in the lecture hall. Can you help me to switch on aircon? If they don't know, I won't be able to answer that question, or I will respond to the question they won't accept, right? So that is one thing, one strength. You will be able to engage students. Okay, I never met that student, but because it was like during the COVID-19, right? I talked to her, but yesterday she messaged. Because she had to go to the neighborhood. Alright, so these are some of the academic rewards, awards, and recognition that you can put in your portfolio. Alright? Whatever that you have here, please do elaborate. Okay, what I have small and big, alright? For example, this one, most innovative content 2012, the SMTG Academic Seminar. Why I made it bigger? Because I think it is one of the important events in my life. Alright, after I started in USM 2008. Alright, so when I got this after 4 years, USM level, I was like, wow! I think in 4 years I achieved that, and that was the first time Prof. Karim, my boss, recognized me. Before that, you don't know who am I. Okay, because I sit in my company and I do my work. Alright, after I won that one, then I go, oh, this is, we can get a new person to help the SM for that. Alright, so, and then, I got the undercover to go high, I got the AN and so on. Alright, this is something that I can remember in this school like that. But, you know, the most important part you might want to highlight and in a narrative way in your portfolio. For example, this one. Alright? So I got it in 2018. Okay? So I was the only Asian people who get the gold award. Alright? In that particular event. Alright? So because I was alone at that time, I brought my husband together with me and he got to wear the USM. He already was not USM, but just, you know, went together with me. And then, you know, everybody was from Australia, from New Zealand, Hong Kong, and so on. Alright? And then the prize was... when I got back, I was the only Indian, I was the only Asian, and it was like, okay, it is something for me, alright? It is something for me that I found that, you know, I need to elaborate that in my portfolio. Alright, so you choose. So whatever recognition that you have, you need to choose the best. Or maybe you would like to say, for example, this month, Award to University in 2018. So you might want to say something about that because it's just a single award. country, but you can see the world after you got an EEN. So you might want to, you know, tell me because I was overconfident, not overconfident. I was overconfident and so on. Yeah, it's a challenge, right? When you got something big and then sometimes you got something big and then you try something else that you think that, oh, I must be a winner as well. Right? You must do a reflection on that. Alright? And then this year I got the grand prize for Pitch USM. Okay, I got 20K in cash. Okay, so something that you know you need to highlight. And then if you got something, you might not, you know, you go like that. You might want, you might go up and then you go down. And then you go up to the key bands. Alright? So highlight your awards and recognition. Even a small recognition will do. Okay. Okay. It's okay. Just a little, I'll share with you the okay. Alright. So your teaching portfolio should present selected information on teaching activities and evidence of teaching effectiveness. Alright? Evidence. Okay, I like this balance so much. So until now I'm using balance since 2019. Until now I subscribe to balance. Alright. And then right, these are the links. These are the important links that you know you might want people to have an idea for my YouTube, my balance, my website and so on. I've got a podcast website and so on. Alright, you don't have to take photo. Links in the the slide. Alright. Okay, so this is one of the evidence of teaching effectiveness. This is from students. Okay. How many times did you do a reflection in your class? You ask your students to do feedback or reflection. Okay, how did you do that? Okay, they did the reflection in parental grant. Okay, you have alright, so you are the new lecturer. Okay, alright, this is good actually. Because you haven't started yet. Okay, so what do you think? How many times do you do your feedback for you get feedback from your students?
Seriously, recorded, I do try. So that at the beginning of the class, usually they already register and they go to all the performance and everything. That is actually one of the requirements. I think that I need what is it, and one of the questions is about what they expecting from me. And finally, after finish the class, usually I did one more paper. And this is an animal that these students need to explore themselves, they can just enter a comment. I also always see what is the mark and the comment that student made for me in the C-test. This is another thing. For the post-graduate student, I receive a lot of messages from students and also complaints that they wrote in their Facebook website or any other and certain documents. Going to get a card from the student and a gift, many type of gift from the student and all the notes, thank you and what is the value that they did in 3 years in Multimedia. This also is a support from us.
Alright, so what you should do, what have you done with the, for example, with the flower, with the buah-buah, how you get cards, what did you do with that?
Many of them I took pictures, I kept it and some of them I posted to my family and friends to show them this is what student education.
Okay, yes. And then what did you do with, for example, a student's tag you Facebook from Eric. Eric was my student. Alright, so he got this 2017 Most Innovative Lecturer Award by PDU.net. Alright, he uploaded his certificate in Facebook. But you see, the thank you, Azidah Ruzidin. I was not involved in giving whatever, but he said thank you to me. Alright, your inspiration, innovativeness are the motivation of my achievement. So I became his inspiration to do something in his class so that he got the recognition as the most innovative lecturer of all. It is not me who get the certificate, he got the certificate, but he recognized me as the inspiration. This can be included in my portfolio because, you know, it is not a recognition from institution, whatever, but I impact someone's learning, okay? I impacted him so that he do innovation in his classroom. This is one of the important things that need to be included. If you have this from your students in Facebook or whatever, screenshot and keep it. You might not know what you are going to do today, but it is an important and important thing to be included in your portfolio, okay? So, start screenshot whatever you have, or whatever thank you from your students and so on, because it will actually... So, this is another a screenshot from Facebook, okay? Azidah is a surgeon in USM Korea, alright? Kelantan. So, she writes something, she wrote something. Here in Facebook, so I just screenshot, I don't know what to do, but you know, it is her recognition of my expertise that influenced her as an educator as well. She's a lecturer, okay? And then we have, this is a teacher, she was my student, okay? She said that, okay, she liked my course, okay? That's why she got an A. Alright, so this is the evidence that the effectiveness of your class. Okay, so start screenshot whatever, because she put my photo and then she put my name. So I think, you know, it's okay for you to don't plagiarize, okay? Yeah, because it is about you. That's right. So he will put it in your portfolio. Alright, I also have this. This is laporan penilaian pengajaran. Okay, end of semester. So I've got 100% here, and then 40% here. But all of the comment, good comments from my students, she inspired the Azidah is a good teacher, whatever lah, blah 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 blah, put it in your portfolio. Alright? So these are the evidence of teaching effectiveness that you need to include in your portfolio. Start collecting your evidences, and then after you collect, you also need to tell people what happened there. Don't just put whatever and what does the evidence give meaning to your academic life? That is the most important. Everybody will get thank you from their students. Also, although the students, they don't like you, but they will say thank you. Okay? Sometimes, alright? Maybe I'll be just be quiet, but usually they will say thank you. Okay? After your online class, you can see thank you doctor, repeated thank yous. But you don't know whether they listen or not to your class. Alright? So, give evidence. You know, you need to describe what happened. The teaching portfolio. Alright? So, first you will have a teaching philosophy. Okay, like I mentioned earlier, you need to have your teaching philosophy. So, now you can have your teaching philosophy. Alright, so I'm going to give you time to think of your teaching philosophy. Alright, usually in your academic portfolio, you will write your teaching philosophy. So, one page or more document that highlights your philosophy of teaching, discuss theory or theories, and pedagogical techniques, and how you create an inclusive classroom. Okay, so in here, okay, under the module, right, there are the theories here.
Because in my handbag, I've got chocolate,
I've got, and sometimes I'll be mainly calm in my class. Alright, so what happened? If they can answer my question, I'll give them mainly calm. They will be very happy. Okay, so next week, this music. Doctor, next week we have peace. If we have peace, I'm going to learn. Because I want mainly calm again. For example. So, that is behaviors. You give stimulus, they may be calm, whatever stimulus, and then they will learn. Okay, like kaku. If you have immunity cup, it is a behaviorist cup. Because, you know, if they do as fast as they can and then they get their first, they will be awarded. That is behaviorist. You give a stimulus and then they will get reward for that. Alright? That is behaviorist. When you go to class, you give something so that people will respond and learn. Okay? And then cognitive is you believe that all learning happens in their mind. Alright, so you give lecture lah. Okay, you go to class, you give lecture. You pour, you give them all the knowledge and then they will listen, and then they will not angguk. And then when they angguk, maybe they learn lah. Dah tak lah kan? So, and then if you would like to know whether they understand, you give test and things and so on. Alright? So that is cognitivist. Constructivist is where you give experience to the students. For example, if you would like to teach them how to ride a bicycle, so you will bring one bicycle to your classroom and then you teach them, okay, first you need to sit on the seat and then, okay, you try to balance and then. So they will experience how to ride a bicycle and then from that experience, they learn how to ride a bicycle. That is constructive. So you need that, you give the experience, whatever experience within your course, that is constructive. So you need that, they are less lectures, but you give them whatever activities. Okay, so that they will learn. Connectivist, this is the latest theory whereby the theory connectivism is about using technology. Okay, you connect your student with your student using technology, the students connect with each other using technology and they learn from that. Alright, that is connectivism. Alright, so these are the main four learning theories. Okay, so if you understand what I meant by the theories, you try to reflect to your teaching philosophy. Meaning that, okay, when I go to my class, what did I do? Right? What did I do? So, do I give lectures? If I give lectures all the time, then I am a cognitive lecturer. Right? When I go to class, I ask my students to hands on. They do collaborative learning. They do project-based learning. They do projects. You give them a question, then they have to explore the question and go Google and so on. You might be constructivist or connectivist or combined. Okay, you can combine all the theories. If you use all, it's okay. Okay, but when you describe the four learning theories and relate it to your what you do in your classroom, it must match. Okay, then people will know your stand. Okay, then you are always in this in your class. But please choose the dominant theory, okay, for yourself. Okay, so for example, in your classroom, when you go here, yeah. So you describe your teaching philosophy and then evidence. Evidence might be you put a diagram, you put a photo, maybe your student or video, maybe a video of your class and whatever. Okay, a quote, whatever lah. The evidence or something that will support your statement of yourself. For example, this description might be I believe in active learning. When I go to my class, I do this and this and this. Okay. By doing this, I believe that my students will learn more, they will experience and blah 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 blah. Okay, I'm going to give you around 20 to half an hour to think of your decision. This is the main part in your portfolio. Alright, and then what I did in my portfolio was alright, what happened here, I put my history philosophy as a library. How was the behavior? So sekarang kan, koyak kertas and all that. So, how was the behavior? I give them stimulus and then they have to respond. Okay, then before we have to draw. Okay, then I say, okay, if you don't draw like what I said, then I'm going to koyak your kertas. That is their stimulus. The rasanya dia adalah dia respon dia ni, they are going to draw it nicely according to whatever they have. Okay, so that was me in the content when I teach graphic design. And then I become, then this is where I went to USM. I became a constructivist lecturer. Okay, I did experience. Okay, I asked my students to bring their laptop in the lecture hall because I teach 200 students. Okay, I cannot teach in the 30 computers in the computer lab because I have so many students, so I need to give them experience in the lecture hall. Okay, immediately. So then from this, I become a constant. I give them experience, building their knowledge, and then give them meaning to what we have learned. Alright? So these are my teaching philosophy, and then I become, that makes me reach the scholarship of teaching. Then this is becoming flexible learning because I have no tutorial anymore. Okay, I have no tutorial because there's no point going to the computer that I do tutorials. Because I have so many students, I cannot do that. So, no tutorials, my class is flexible. I come to class at 9 a.m. and then I say, okay, I'm going to give you this, and this. We'll be back in this lecture hall at 11. And you are going to present what you have done later on at 11, but you need to go to the port, Wi-Fi port, so that you can do your work. Okay, so that it will be faster. So my students, they will sit around USM, around the lecture hall and you. So this is my teaching philosophy that I explained under this lah. Alright? So, but I'll visualize my teaching philosophy. So now I would like you to visualize your teaching philosophy. Using the theory that I mentioned just now, the four theories, and then what you do in the classroom. Imagine. Okay, around 30 minutes to 30 minutes. 30 to 30 minutes. And then write it down in the Word document that you downloaded. Alright? So, write it, you download the download the TV here, you can put your evidence here, whatever you want to put. Alright? First, we are going to do the teaching process. Alright? Next, one, two,
Ada tu.
your teaching philosophy?
Okay. Right, so I think having the opportunity and also experience in going into the training of teaching and learning inside quite early in my academic career. So I am quite, I would say, exposed to different education. So I find myself I design my classes and my teaching sessions so that it reflects that constructivist approach itself. So I find that I think this could be the way that I learn now. That I find that unless I can make the connection or make the bridge from information to knowledge, then that is, I would say it's quite difficult because you can get information and get up, especially now. So the key is to teach the students and that students learn how to convert that knowledge, discover that information to knowledge.
What do you mean by teach?
Probably teach is not really a good word for it. So I get the students to then construct that knowledge by doing activities. That's how I design the sessions that I have. So I don't have to do lecture. I would introduce the topic of these are the key things that you need to learn. These are the resources, the main resources, but always you need to explore further. So the main ones are the right source of information. But I believe that there are heritage of information. I even teach this to students, especially the ones that for the first time having learning sessions with me.
Right, so what we can see constructivist, but you do use the others or not at all?
I avoid the labels.
Actually, I did not complete my writing, but I just want to share how my teaching philosophy is the content of my teaching philosophy. Basically, my teaching philosophy is behaviorism and connectivity. Because my lecture basically is social science, geography, so we do a lot of teaching in the classes and then in physical geography, sometimes I bring them to that, especially in my class for soil geography, we do a lot of testing and that works a lot. So the behavior and the cognitive is very important in my, that is my foundation. But recently, since the weather is over, I found basic philosophy in my teaching. This is in this 2 years time. This is the cognitive is changing, where I get connected with my students and receive feedback and all the communication change my philosophy of teaching. Those days is look like a one-way teaching. It's me talking to students and then I treat the students, I evaluate students and get back their marks or something like that. But this time it's two-way communication. Students talk to me, I listen to them, I give them and students respond to me. I also care about students and their behavior. I not able and know where is the student location since the pandemic, and aware of students, not only the academic, but also not academic activity, because now we are listening to students via all these internet platforms. So different philosophy in my teaching, just taking these two that, so now I can see the changes in my teaching philosophy.
Alright, okay, so we have
constructs, right? And then, how about yours? So, I used to be lecture. The 2 hours would be always fully occupied lectures. Nothing more than that. But I think, during the COVID pandemic, the 2 years that we are at home, we were forced to use other ways of teaching. So during that time, because we have this course, which is a master course, a master level physics course, and our students were actually benefit in the, before the COVID time, they actually had the benefit of being in the hospital, so it's a hospital-based environment. Already it's somewhat an experiential environment for them. But because of COVID, they cannot come. So in order to help them to sort of have a bit of an experience during the 2 years that were from, there's a few MCOs and there are some really great in between, so I was able to get a few students together and we carried out practicals. So we did the practicals in the hospital and we recorded, we take pictures, we recorded how we did it and we explained it, and then eventually we could we collected the videos, we produced clips of videos and with writings and say describing what we're doing here, and then even with the material that we basically we carry out the experiment, and then we have the measurement, we provide the material for the students, upload it, and I ask them to say, so this is how we did it, and look at this video, and then this is the result that we got, and I've already scanned for you and it's here, and now try to analyze this work with them. So that was what I did in that time when we tried to do virtual practical for them. And now even if after post-pandemic, although we are going to go back to physical doing all that experiment again, I feel that those materials that we developed that time can still be useful as material resources, which I would put it out for them and say that this is what we plan to do. You look at this video and then you have some idea of what we're going to do, and then you will carry out the practical again. So I don't know what this is called. I'm not from education background. I just dump anything that I think may work. So other things that I do use as well is also I explore with Kahoot, I explore with Google Form. So during the pandemic also we were concerned about the internet type of capacity of some students. So I did survey before the session to say, what are the internet that you have? Do you use broadband, do you use data, do you use mobile? And to identify students who maybe are only using mobile or data to access material. So that if they need, how can we help them? So, yeah.
Alright. I don't know what. TVs?
What?
I don't know what. Is it Astral TVs? Is it behaviorist? Is it cognitive? Is it internet TVs?
Music?
You go from cognitivist, because you do lectures, right? Only lectures, and then you turn into constructivist, because you give experience to the student, right? You explore virtual, whatever activities that you mentioned just now, right? So you are going towards constructivist, but still in the process. And then you also look at the potential of connectivity. Okay, at currently you are still between the top 50% of startups. Yeah. You are still exploring. Maybe because you just open up to the fact that actually you can do your teaching like this. You might be able to explore whatever you do in the classroom before, but then, and then you now turn your class into a very active class, much more active, student-centered. Focus. Alright, so maybe from the top is because you don't have parents, you are not being students to the students. Alright? And I think you know that's why it's quite interesting that you are being experiential constructive. Alright? And then it is constructive, totally constructive, meaning that you are exploring various tools, but you are not maybe if you use technology it might be very minimal. You are using mostly something whatever you can with the students, they are actively doing the project whatever, okay, and then you are not lecturing. Right? So you are definitely a constructive instructor. Okay, same as Dr. Zahir, but are you looking at connectivities more and more, or you are still doing more? Yeah, I think it's okay. We not necessarily have to adopt connectivities although in the technology era. Why I see that? Because the students themselves, they are into technology, okay, at home and so on. So we might not want them to be using technology for the purpose of learning, right? But we can use it just minimal so that they will be bored and so on. Other than that, we can explore more hands-on, more experiential, face to face. Without having yourself to explore more. Okay. Some people, they are comfortable with technology. Okay. But some people, they are not comfortable. But if you would like to explore more technology, ask your students to do that. Not me. You mean that you feel that, okay, I am like just backwards, I'm not using technology, I'm not connecting it. It's okay. But whatever it is, ask your students. They are going to do the exploration, not you. You are old enough. Okay, for me, I'm teaching education technology. Of course, I explore technology, but for those who are not in technology, then you don't have to. But if you would like to, then ask your students. They are more advanced in the of technology use. Alright, I know you are not teaching yet.
I've been teaching infrastructure for 10 years, although I'm new at IUCEL, but I'm not new as an educator. For me, I found that I, at some point of my career, I have applied at least one of those modules. Because it is not possible for us to teach all the students same way. Like for undergraduate students, we want to teach them in one approach, and then we teach the post-grad students, we want to apply another method maybe. So yes, I have the mixture, but after the pandemic, I found that I am moving more towards the capitalism. Because, the technology base. For business, it is actually a mixture of capitalism, then constructivism, because we need to communicate two ways. Just lecturing or just teaching them is not enough. They need to feedback in a way that I can understand. They can apply those learning materials and whatever their knowledge is in the practical field. Because that one is very important. And also, behaviorism applies for all level of students, but for the undergraduate level students, they prefer it, that the lecturer reward them with something, even if it is a mere bonus mark. So we have to evolve four of those, depending on the topic we are teaching
undergraduate students in the future.
But which one do you think dominates students?
Nowadays, the last one.
The politics. I like the fact that you were mentioning about the undergraduate and postgraduate. Okay, so you might, yes, I agree with you that we might have different approaches between the postgrad and the undergrad. Right, because sometimes, you know, for undergraduates, they like behaviorists. Maybe because we have more students, maybe, in our class, like my course, I have all the students in the School of Educational Studies take my course. So I have like 200 per semester, every semester. So when we teach 200 students, for example, we always have difficulty to identify the students. Okay, we only know a few of them. 80% we don't know, we can't recognize. So by using behaviorists, we might be able to know more about our students. Like we compare to the other approaches. But constructivist is also okay, but you need to actually think of the project, whatever that you need to know better your students. But for postgraduate, I think it is if you do behaviorist only, because they might be working, I think it might be we don't need that stimulus. Okay, they are in the course because of they want to. Okay, but the undergraduate they enroll because they think that they are going to look for jobs after they graduated, not for the adult learners. So yes, different approaches might be there for different learners. Okay, alright. So I know you are not teaching. So what do you think will be your teaching
philosophy?
They need you all to put the theory behind whatever you are doing in your classroom. Okay, what theory? So the four theories would be enough. Meaning that, for example, Jeannie, she is doing virtual, whatever, virtual lab, medics, for example. So whatever you do in that particular virtual learning will be based on maybe one theory. Okay, for example, construction. You are going to maybe students will be able to do hands-on virtually, for example. So maybe you are using AR, VR, whatever. So that will be based on one here. You need to mention that in one section of the article form. So when you do that, these theories are important. You will need to understand the theories, how it can be implemented in the classroom. Okay, whatever we do in our class, actually we are looking at this theory. When you look back, sebenarnya memang ada pun, but you always know that there are any theory, there is any theory that related to what you do in your class. So go back and define your teaching philosophy, because jangan buang, jangan buang lah kalau kita lahir nak apply for AAM, Dr. Firuza nak apply for AAM next year. So please continue writing, and maybe you would like to do the diagram like I did, so that you know it is easier for people to understand your teaching philosophy. Alright? Next. Okay, after teaching philosophy. Philosophy may be grounded in theories, your belief about learning. If let's say you believe that students, macam tadi Jenny, she told me that she gave lecture kan, before this time, you give lecture, but then you realize that only you give lecture, they still don't understand what you have lectured. So, do you believe that lecture will help the students to learn? So maybe you do that without your own belief that students learn from lectures. Okay, so you need to actually think that if I believe that students learn when they listen, or every student we have to relate via lecture, so we might not really need that. And it also show that your belief about teachers' role in learning. So meaning that when you have to give lecture, if you believe that you have to be, tadi dah macam dah goyah dah sikit. You are a bit goyah, meaning that you know, you think that it is not necessary. She thinks that not necessary, she has to be lectures. So, you don't believe that, you know, teacher's role in the learning is being a teacher. You might be facilitating the students only. Alright? And then, what are your goals for students learning? I need my students to be able to achieve what? Alright? So, I want them to be able to do what? Okay? And then, the most important thing is, okay, teaching philosophy is just one section. Alright? Teaching action should reflect the need. So if let's say your belief is I would like my students to my class to be active. Okay, my students need to be very active in my class. They need to go here and there, they need to do this and so on and so on. But then your class teaching method is in lecture. Then that is your belief and what you do does not jive, does not match. Alright? So whatever you say about teaching philosophy, to reflect in your teaching. I think that the evidence needs to be there. You don't take, people don't take photo of you while you are doing lecture, but the photo that you are going to do is the students in the activity in the class. They might be doing whatever, alright? They might be discussing, they might be using Quizlet, for example. Alright, so that you can see the collaboration and so on. Okay, that was easy. philosophy. Alright. Alright, evidence of teaching effectiveness. What is students' rating? Okay, students' rating. Maybe you have it in your end of semester evaluation. And then peer evaluation of teaching or CDAE or etc. Okay, so your friends evaluate you as a lecturer. Okay, you can ask your friend. Okay, you go to your class and see how you are teaching. Right? Or maybe you are doing team teaching. Okay, in USM we actually have team teaching, mostly team teaching. But sometimes I do for me myself, I do like to teach by myself. Because it is much more flexible. If I want to do innovation, intervention in my class, you know, students won't compare me with others. Okay. Teaching is you teach one class with two. One class is being taught by two lecturers. Maybe you divide half of the semester with your three, or maybe you come together in class together. Can also. Alright? Self-evaluation. Do you do self-evaluation? Have you evaluate your own teaching? Pernah buat tak? Macam mana saya buat? Okay. Bukan. Buat senyap-senyap pula. Okay. I think I'm just for example. Sometimes I do like
I give one example. This is a biography class. Sometimes I give lecture in the road street. Maybe first after that, every student will left. But some lab experiments that should be done in the third week, I think students have in the sixth week. The students forgot the experiments and things like that. So I feel that I should start giving lecture in the lab. Maybe half an hour lecture and then you go to the lab. Because before this, I did all the lectures and after that, I think the students will left. Then I noticed students forgot the step and think what they should do and what is the purpose of that lecture. So now I change my entire. Any work, any topic that any student to do that, I bring that lecture, go back. The same before let's start, I give lecture half an hour. I show them this is the purpose of this class and they are learning this with the next. And after this class, they are expected they are going to do the testing. So it's immediate. I think this is very good. Because before this, students cannot connect the lecture and the lab work. So when I moved the class to lab and break, I saw a big improvement in this.
Okay, yeah. So meaning that you head back to your previous class and see how the students were performing, and then you think that you need to do some enhancement, some modification to your team. That is self-evaluation. Evaluate and move then to improve. Alright, so Dr. Peterson might want to keep that in mind because later on you might want to actually put it into words. Alright, you might want to choose one topic. Alright, one topic, for example, whatever topic in geography that you are teaching. And then in this particular topic, we are discussing about, we are looking at what. And then, the previous semester, I did like this. And then what happened after that is the result of the students are mostly very low. Most of the students get 50 marks and below, for example. Then I think I try to design my class differently whereby this one here. And then from there I can see the improvement of my students then. So you know, you need to put that inwards. Alright? So that is self-evaluation. Sorry? No. Doesn't have to be formal. So meaning that is your story. But for example, if let's see, the people that mentioned about self-evaluation, you need to have evidence of the, for example, student result. Okay, the past semester they have like low marks for most of the class. Maybe 80%, 70% of the students get less than B, for example. Then you have that marks. And then from that marks, you evaluate, do self-evaluation and think you think that you need to do the intervention in your class. Then you do the intervention. Then the evidence, you might want to see, okay, one semester I did like this, then these are the marks of the students. Yes, you can. Alright, yes, you can. And for Artery, for example, if you like to join Artery, that is one of the important evidence that you need to do. The students' achievement, performance, yeah. Alright. And then, evaluation by department chair. Alright, if your team would like to evaluate your team and so on, you might, he or she might want to produce a letter. Alright, then you might want to include that in your portfolio. Issue recognition and awards, like I mentioned just now, issue recognition and awards from students, no, sorry, recognition that I screenshot from my student just now, it was his recognition, but it goes back to me. Award, whatever award that we will achieve is with the certificate and so on. Alright, so let me just forget about that. The impacts of your teaching. That is why just now I have shown you what. So these are the impacts that we would like to see. Yeah? Okay, meaning that after you have worked 5 years, 10 years, what are your impacts? Maybe for 5 years the impact will be different. After 10 years the impact will be different. So you might want to actually share the progress, okay, of your impact to the students. What else belongs in the portfolio? Alright, before I will go here, I will let you go to that. We have done the teaching philosophy. Alright, so I would like you to go to your teaching documentation. Alright, in the word 5. Okay. So I would like you to you might want to describe all courses that you have been teaching. Alright, kalau tak ingat tak apa, if you don't remember, it's okay. But just try to list down all the courses that you are teaching. From the first day you come to UM or from the first day you teach. Okay, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 11, 20. You have been teaching 20 courses. Alright. And then, okay, in a portfolio, you might put every courses that you will teach, but you might want to focus, okay, if you are applying for AN, at least 2 courses, but at least 3, that are very important to you. Okay, not necessarily you teach 10 subjects, all 10 subjects you want to teach. Okay, put into all subjects that you think it is important to be highlighted. Okay, 3 is enough. Right, if you have more than it is good enough. Okay, but at least 3, don't put only 1. Okay, if you put only 1, then people will see that. Very little will see that it is not enough. You are not comprehensive, actually, you are not versatile and so on. Alright, so please include in your portfolio as well. For, let's say you are a contract here, right? Yes, so let's say you are being called for an interview in other institution. Right? Rather than you bring your CV, better you bring your portfolio. Alright, much better because it is comprehensive. The institution will see your achievement, your narration about what you do, and it will actually help you to get the job. Alright, so it is for various purposes, like I mentioned earlier. So I have been in the SM since 2008. Alright, and last time my husband was working in Tanjung Malik, whereby I was in Penang. Alright. So for information, I have applied for two other universities, and both both I got the job. But the first one, I was like, okay, I was dong-dong at that time because it was my good year in USM, and then I said, okay, I don't want to go to that university. Okay, because I love USM so much, although my husband, the love of my life is far away, but I love USM more, so I stayed in USM after I got the offer from that particular university. Then, after that, I feel that, okay, it is hard. My husband is from AL. So at that time, his family, his dad was really sick. His late dad was really sick. And then he has to, like, during the weekend, he has to travel from Kathmandu to Penang. And then during the day, he has to take care of his late father in KL. So he has to travel every day. So I was meeting my husband, so I said, okay, I need to actually go. So I got the job in UIA, but the day I got the job, the offer, my husband got the offer to go back to Penang. So then I that it's better to go back to Penang, so that it's much more easier to move one person compared to the family who moved there. Okay, so, but the main thing I would like to highlight is the portfolio. You just go anywhere with your portfolio. You don't have, you know, if you have been working more than 10 years, I think your certificates is like me. You have piles of certificates that you don't know which one to choose. So choose the best certificate, explain what you get from the certificates, alright? And then just put the important the important achievement in your portfolio. Alright? So yeah, so even if you are not permanently, might not be permanently here, the portfolio will actually help you to maybe go on in the run. Okay, so start with your portfolio. So in here for the teaching documentation, please share after what you are teaching. Right before we go to lunch. Alright? What you are teaching and what course, but highlight one for the media. One course that you think you have done any innovation or intervention that different from other courses. Usually you don't do the innovation. First you don't do the innovation in every classes. Maybe you don't have time and so on. Right. But gradually, when you feel that this class is successful, then you are going to implement that in other classes. You start with one class first. So, like I told you just now, why not you share here the one that you explained just now. What the name of the course, what topic specifically, and then what did she do. Okay, I think that is potential. Or if you would like to try, for example, that is potential because you are doing the transformation of your class. Okay, from the dull class to an active class. So what did you do? But if you are going to go for Akhi next year, please start compiling your evidences. You need evidence. Alright, so I didn't need you all to think of one subject for those who are not teaching you. You are teaching them how do you, for example, you are supervising, right? So how do you supervise? Okay, your documentation on supervision. How do you, like for me, during this pandemic, for your education, I have 20 PhD students. Alright, 20 PhD students. So there are many, so many. PhD students, and I found it difficult. Firstly, it was hard for me to supervise. But now I feel it very, I feel it becomes easier and easier. Why? Because I use technology. I have my iPad, I have my computer. So I use both during my supervision wherever the day can have a look on, can join the session, and then they will see how I supervise other people. They will see where they got wrong and so on, and all is important. Okay, so if I did that test, I admit that I'm using WebEx for my each of my post-grad session. I use two devices, one is iPad, one is my MacBook. Then I will share my iPad as well. Again, my MacBook will be my main web aesthetic. And everyone will join, and then I will share the iPad screen, and then I can scribble on the iPad. The student will be able to look at the iPad. It's not that I have to, you know, use the video and so on in the books, but I can scribble on that iPad. So I need to write down the process. Okay, and then what are the students' feedback from that particular process? That is important. Okay, so choose. Okay, you can describe here whatever courses that you have, but at the end choose one that you feel that you have done intervention, and then what you should do, what are the evidences, and yeah, I will do that with them.
So the evidence is like photos, and then is that the photos of what you need to do, is it the course?
Meaning that,
yes,
if you have students meeting, for example, meaning that students' performance, that can be evidence. Students' feedback, for example, they give feedback at the end of the class or at the end of the semester. I like this class so much because I can explore things after like this, they will write down. Okay, that is also the evidence. Okay, the students see what the students see about the evidence of the class. You can also have photos. If you have video that be taken during the class, for example, that student is good, so rakan-rakan-rakan, then you can do that as well. And then whatever evidence that you can include in for that particular topic, subject, is
I can share the class that I did. This is one of my lectures that I created when I came to UCMalat. The title of this course is Agriculture and Environment. It's created in 2008. And this is the first course that I introduced in UCMalat. This course, until now we already changed 3 times the code of the courses, but the title is still Agriculture and Environment. This course is very famous. Sometimes I had 130 students in the class. This is selective course. And this course, the assessment is 60% is project work. And a lot of students coming from different departments in this course because they feel excited. Because half of the class, they go for people, do the data collection, come back and do report, presentation, and submission. You know, but presentation is small, it's just 30%. The rest all is from projects. I get a lot of compliments from students for this class, but one of the biggest challenges after presenting this class for 3-4 sections, I found that there's a lot of teaching partners in every group, you know. Because each group has 4 students or 5. Usually 5, because 120 I think 100 so many groups. So usually I give 5. There is at least 1 or 2% is inactive. And they give 3,000 excuses not to be active in the group. So and then I start thinking how to improve this participation in the group. I saw your participant from EDEX for US Life. Yeah, then I joined that. And I was thinking they said what you want to solving identity student participation in the class. So I joined that. I changed the student marking system for this course, 60%. 5 marks is peer review. So the friends in the group mark this mark for each of them. And it was good. I won award for that. Like I said, I get silver award. I get sector input qualification for that. I created the rubric, then I presented it. Then so many things that out of this but one of the best thing is student involvement in the class improves a lot. Everybody said their parents give zero. So this improvement changed a lot of my thinking, and I also share this with my faculty member how to do peer review forms. So what is the parameter that you can set, and how we want to Okay.
So this is, I think, one of these small
institutions. Yeah, I think that is one of the examples that you should put in your portfolio. Alright? There is whatever, you know, you need to elaborate what you have done because people would like to know. What the problem is, people usually they just put the evidence. Because you think the evidence is important. Without describing what you have done, the evidence, they can't speak by themselves. Alright, so we need to elaborate. That's why I have the description very big, but the evidence less small. Because you can put whatever evidence, but the evidence needs description. Alright? Okay.
I thought that was quite nice, but because in my course as well, I also did this peer review thing, but I don't know how to do it. I just say that give me some for your assignments. If it is a group, I say that you then have to at the end of your assignment, you have to say that who put your name and how many percentage you contributed. That's just my simplest way of saying how you contribute. And that percentage, you guys have to decide, agree on that or not, then you give me that. So that was just my simplest way. I don't know how much to trust that, but from my experience, they seem to be very kerjasama. Everybody give 100% or equivalent. So I have this difficulty to actually say, can I really trust that? Do they really all contribute equally? Or they're just really kind to each other? So I don't know. So I'd be interested to know, you know, what mechanism that you actually have that could be more trustworthy.
Yeah, basically, I looked at that. I also checked the mental integrity for how they engage friends and other doctors and nurses. It's not nurses, peers, nurses. And I think it's a community community. I checked the format, they did come back to the community. Then I ran off and then I left it and did the market.
Yeah, I think that would be good because I have this idea of trying to embed how can I do a 360 evaluation of students in one of my courses because I wanted to incorporate things about ethics and professionalism. How can we evaluate that? I'm thinking if you can get assessment from peers or even people that clinics and all that, but how? But that would be something interesting to know.
Yeah, I think these are potentials that you can do in your own classroom. Okay? And then, you know, while you feel that the period I was explaining, I was like, okay, this might be from the University, this mentioning, yes, penilaian alternatif, but I think penilaian alternatif is the best one. Pentaksiran alternatif, there are various category in Afri. So, I think okay, like program masuk tiba, you can join two categories for Afri. I think that is how, actually what happened in your discussions to me are your reflection on your own class. Alright, the purpose of portfolio is for you to do reflection. Alright, sometimes we do reflection, but sometimes when we do reflection, we don't know how to do. Alright, so when we write our reflection, then we know what are we supposed to do, what are we supposed to enhance in our class. Okay, it doesn't only show, you know, and then we can share. So that we can improve their classes as well. So I think yeah, that is good. So you can feel it later on. Okay, it's now almost 1. Alright. So we have lunch for now. Actually in my schedule I put 2, we start at 2. So I can be honest. As fast as we can. Because I want to stop at 4:30 because I'm going to cross to Bali later on. I got jam pula. Yeah. So by 4:30 I hope we can finish. So around 2 or 2:50 maybe. Yeah.
process that really you have to do information in that particular course. Alright? And then the synopsis of the course, all whatever that you have in the course, for example, how many students per semester. Okay? And then the documentation that you have. What types of people here, what types of activities that you need in the class. I don't know, for example. So, but if you would like to put up, then it will be very exhausting for others to whatever you teach. Yeah, but for example, if you would like to do you're right. You have the course description, simplify, the outcomes, sensitivity, and assessment. Alright? So, for all of this one, if you have 12 or more than 12 courses that you have to teach, if you would like to add the what we call table 4, for example, we have table 4 and course outline. If you would like to add as appendices at the back of your portfolio, you can. If you would like to put them. But for description, for explanation, there's two things. So, you can get, for example, I like PGT for 360 units. So, I'm going to add the course description, synopsis, revise, learning outcomes, methodology, and assessment. I'm going to put, for example, I have blueprints for that particular course. Alright? I have the methodology, how do I teach? So, if you are using table 4, have you seen table 4, right? Can you create table 4? So, if I'm creating table 4, I'm going to include that I have no lectures. So, I don't teach lectures, but I teach others. You get the lecture, tutorial, practical, and oh, hey.
Impact.
documentation. Usually we will document whatever measures that we have set. Yesterday we were talking about, we have it in our LMS. Okay, we have it in our LMS. Yeah. Yes. Yes, but the portfolio, alright, that's why you just select whatever you have to go to your people. Yeah. Okay. For me, I choose the best course that I can. Okay. The best innovation, my favorite. And then the most activity that I have done with my students. Yes. The best class, the best. You feel happy to go to that class. You know that you have done something in that class. And then you have the comprehensive materials from that particular class. Meaning that, for example, you have to describe to somebody about a topic. Okay? You have the assessment, you have the content, you have the materials. So you should have the G-Learning that assessment. You have also, you will be able to actually match the learning outcomes and what are the materials, what are the assessment that you are using in that particular course. Okay? So meaning that when you choose a course that you would like to highlight in your portfolio, consider, okay, that is your best course. The course that you like and you have done something in that particular class. Okay, we are a class that we, there are some classes that we really like to do. Okay, and then you know that you have done something in that particular class. For example, if you teach research methodology, it is like the case. People seldom do innovation research methodology because you are going to teach the same thing. Alright? First, how to write chapter 1, chapter 2, what is research, what is quantitative research, what is whatever. Alright? So people seldom do innovative teaching in research methodology. But let's see, in that course you do something different. Okay, because people don't like to do innovation in that one. They are going to be straightforward. How to do research? Okay? What is quantitative research? What is qualitative research? What is how to analyze your data? Okay? So how do, for example, you are an innovative researcher class academic. In your research methods class, you are going to do something. So the synopsis of your class, the synopsis of your course will be the same as other lecturers. But the innovation that you do in that particular boring research methods class will be different. First is the engagement of students. You should be able to show how the student participate and engage in your class. That is the first thing. So the methods that you are using will be able to get the student to be engaged. Right? So you can see that, you can document that. How you document is up to your ability. Okay? So that is the participation and engagement. Then we are going to look at the performance. So whether they engage or participate, but at the end, they just engage. Maybe you use something, for example, you use some fun activities in the class, but they only participate. They are engaged, but at the end, the performance are low. Then whether it is, then you cannot do that. The engagement, the participation, need to last semester and this semester. You don't have to go back to 2008 anymore. Okay, because we are at, you know, pre-technical
class. Yes, go ahead.
Yes, you need that. Yes, okay. Okay, what is their performance? And then their feedback. Alright, their feedback. That is important. So every time in your class when you teach, okay, please ask the students to give feedback. Simpan, letak dalam padlet, you can put in padlet. Alright, you can ask them, you can use this post-it pad. Okay, the square post-it pad. Ask your student to just write one or two sentences about that particular class. Alright, and then keep that. So, just, you know, so like that, and then you go. That is evidence. Alright? Okay. So, performance, feedback, alright, and then the rubrics that you use for that particular course, that particular topic, for example, the if you have quizzes, if you have whatever, everything that can conclude that you have to be effectively engaged and help students to perform, then that is good. But in the evidence, that's why in this one, I have evidence. Okay, so in a class like this, I will be in the world PCC, I will be a synopsis of the course, I would like to, this is ICT in Malaysia. So in this course, I'm going to expose students to various ICT tools for teaching. Alright, so then I choose a topic. Then when I choose the topic, I'm going to share the comprehensiveness of the teaching and learning, as well as the assessment for that particular. You need to describe everything for one, for example, or for one topic, maybe in 2 or 3 weeks. Alright? Yes. Just one topic. Yeah. You can, yeah, you can, okay, reflection. You just put reflection. Okay, at the end of that particular course, later on I said, okay, I'm just going to put, show them how the student reflects, how they feel, how they do the reflection. However, you just put that talking and so on, all the recommendation, all the evidence, maybe at the end of that particular topic that you discussed with my reflection. In this course, I when I was given this course, I was quite skeptical because it is a theory-based class. And I was wondering how do I make this class act. Okay, something like that. That is your reflection. But after I did this active learning using whatever, I found that my students engage and participate. And I don't know whether the engagement would lead to the higher performance of my students. But, however, after I did some whatever, I found that after I did some tests, okay, then if you say you need test, then the test question should be needed. Okay, so if you think that is secret or you want to expose that, then put it in your portfolio, but make sure that part will cover that maybe for the purpose of applying for anything. You just want to do that, but in the general portfolio, you are not going to do that. Okay. So, what extent do you like to share the course? Usually, yeah, maybe something like a movie, for example, because you even have that, you have the trademark, copyright, whatever, so you don't want to share, it's okay. But for your application, right, you might want to do that. So, it's up. But evidence, here, it can be any. Alright, for example, you choose topic, the evidence is students' work. You can use students' work as an evidence, for example, to ask them to do simulation for that particular topic. So the students do simulation and then they upload it. So you put the topic here. And then if let's say they go do something 3D, then you put the photo of the 3D. It's that. Okay, supervision. Okay, my supervision. Because I did my portfolio here in 2016. Okay. I have my supervision here. companies was one of my solutions in this type of company. So I can share that I was like, these are the recording. So I can just put the ideas here. So this is the evidence on how I do my solution. Alright, so it is online. Alright, I have my iPad, I have me, and then I can put my iPad there without the camera, so that's. So this can be shared as evidence of what I did doing, what I do during my search. So the evidence can be a link, or you can actually turn this to QR code, whatever, so that when people look at your portfolio, you can understand and how the student is done online. Okay, so if your evidence in the recruitment here,
so that is the macam mana tu pula.
You have to do essay. You have only strength one one. You can see my portfolio, I write a lot.
Oh, thank you.
My portfolio is quite, not that big. You know, you can see other people who have had, I found my people in the SF, he applied for me, and he's, he had like nearly 500 But they don't put their portfolio on the weight instead. That's why my portfolio is just like that.
How long do you work with it?
Not that long, because I was forced to do that. So it was like 2 months maybe. But I did have a portfolio before that, but portfolio for I did not have to spend 2 months but I was I didn't get that. I didn't get that. I failed out of the ground. But that was my starting point after that. And my portfolio is just less than 200 million.
So this session is for business.
Yes. That's
why I do not think what the idea.
Because the people who are going to be there in your portfolio will not be in the CDAE. Yes, social science is social science, but social science itself has a big area. You are geography, I'm reading your portfolio. Yes.
So for 1 to 3 and
for the course, for this part, you need the technical part. But I call technical part, which are the syllabus, course description, learning outcomes, CNO 1 up to 3 or 4, alright? Yeah, and then assessment, what types of assessment that you usually do in that part. However, then whatever assignment, exam, quizzes, handouts, lecture outline, and so on. If you have that video recording, you must do that. Alright? If you have PowerPoint slide, then you think it is important to input in your portfolio, you put that, or you just put the title. Okay? And then I think now it is much more easier for you to do with all that compared to during my time, there was no QR code and so on. Yeah, so it was pretty hard. But now it is, for example, you put it in Google Drive, you put the QR code, and then people will be able to access. That's the QR code. Alright? You don't have to write it out or print everything. For example, if you like to have a hard copy of photo. I have a hard copy of photo, but now we don't require the hard copy. Yeah. Alright? But if you have 500 pages, then more than 300. Alright, so, and yes, if you have photos, alright, you with your students and your photo, for example, the student give you one bucket of guac. Thank you, Dr. Fairuza, Firuza, because of you, when I went to this course with the previous lecturer, I failed. But with you, for example, with you, I passed with A. So I really terhutang-huti dekat Dr. Firuza. sudah diadakan. So kami dapat take photo of that one and put as evidence for that particular course. Okay. So you need to do your reflection. You need also to tell people story about what you have done in that class with the evidence of the syllabus, the content, and so on. But yes, as you mentioned just now, use name and notes. Okay? Hello. Just tell people story like you are telling people about yourself. You don't have to teach people about that particular course, but you have to tell people what you do to solve the problems that occurs in your class. You don't have to teach about whatever computer or whatever, no. Just what is the problem? This course is about using technical whatever you are doing, right? How to use the whatever computer, mathematics formula to develop whatever. Okay? Whatever student won't be able to match, okay, to identify what types of formula they are going to use to make sure that the bid won't fall down, for example. Okay? So I feel yeah. You don't have to cheat the person. No, you don't have to teach about the mathematics, but how to solve. Okay, from the mathematics become the student won't understand. So you are going to do innovation in your class so that students will be able to I know now how to identify the problems. Then that needs to be highlighted that in your portfolio. It is not easy. Let's say you teach training workshop for new tech lecturers. They are all engineers. Sometimes most of them are engineering lecturers. So you see that Dr. Azidah is very hard for us because we are technical, we are doing engineering and so on. And you are teaching us. It was not a portfolio workshop, it was using web platforms and technical mentor. Alright, so we see that we are teaching a technical mentor here, the topic by something in mathematics. So we see it is very hard for us to make the class fun because you are teaching mathematics. Very hard. Then I said, okay. How about we try to do this thing? Alright? This topic is hard. You cannot use business. Business is like finding money, so boring, it is so hard to use finding money and mathematics. But I say, okay, how about we try? Okay, so using business, they are going to use their phone and so on. Alright? You have to pop notes and so on. And then at the end, after that particular research class, actually they were able to solve the problem using research, but use collaborative in how to solve the mathematics and so on. Because research, there are questions and so on. I just need one question so that they have to do it together. And then they said, this is possible. You can find the need and occur in engineering. Yes, very technical subject, but you have to be very innovative. You cannot say that, this is a technical class, I don't think you can do it because it is mathematical. Yes, you can. If you use physics, that's not necessarily use that. Kahoot is about doing something fast. You have to do it fast. But if you use physics, it is about getting it right. I think it is still fast, but still you can take your time. Alright, so we train in terms of getting people to engage. Yeah, itu yang kita cari. That is what we are doing. And in the future, No, not necessary. It can be collaborative learning using Google Assignment. But what I mentioned just now is the ability in the class. Okay, I'm here, I'm observing what you are doing in the class, and then the class became very ad hoc. You know, everyone was shouting and so on, but at the end, we were able to solve the problem. Our collaborate, but I think, you know, usually people think that when you give to assignment, the student will be like, sit together and just discuss and so on, you know, not necessary. Okay, they can sit, move there, but they can still collaborate, and it will be a different. Something like that. You know, be different from others. Therefore, you know, we highlight you as different from others. Your idea is important. When you supervise your students, how do you supervise them? Correct? You need to be very knowing so that, you know, they can graduate on time, for example. Okay? And people ask me, because how can you get most of your students graduate on time? You are acting position. You are traveling here and there, but still your students graduate on time. What did you do? Alright, so that is something that I need to highlight in my portfolio so that, you know, it's not easy to get 5,000, 5,000, 4,000 right every year. Okay, sometimes, like last year, I got 3 students each. So I got 50,000. Right, it's not easy. Okay, but then later comes like, you know, top down. Oh, I got 2. I can buy, you know, whatever I want for my business. It's good. Okay, so one more thing. Yes. This is the difficult part to actually look for evidence. So if you have never or less selfie in your student's time, just that selfie is your student.
Yeah,
it's
something that
I have
to do.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
This is, you know, next week you will be starting your class. So why not, you know, start with use this? Okay, hello, I got to study that as class before I start my class. My advice to you, all of you, and I always advise our two lecturers, start selfie with your students. Whatever you do, take photos. That can be there. Even your photos, whatever, can be the type that, you know, a student give to you, just keep it, you know, take photo, and then put it in the photo. You don't know what to do with it now, but you can have it in the photo. Okay, and I can't think, you know, I have the photos for them. Because it's not sometimes it doesn't come up. So the topic that I think is it will be a miracle that you have the somebody send you the week after. Yes. So that is an important point actually, yeah. Because why it is important that students approach you and so on, because but it is like, you know, students appreciate what you have done. You think you can mention all the things related to competition? Yes, you can. But I just want to share with you, I want to share with you.
Right.
during his first attack, he was called to the business commission, but he was there lah, masih tinggalkan the business commission. Then I won the AN, but then after 2 years, he was he applied. Okay, because you need to have 5 year gap, yes. Alright, so the after 2 years he applied and he said, I don't want to use the, I'm using the old portfolio, but I would like to, because you, he said, I use the Malay, I use Malay, he used English. Okay, but this time you would like to change all his portfolio into Malay. So he changed and then the portfolio was not selected. Even for okay, so then I said, you know, you shouldn't actually change your English portfolio to PM. You have no purpose for that, just because you know, you like it. So be yourself. So if people ask me, you buy a portfolio English or PM? Okay. So you have this, and you have this. Also a story of your I have a couple of this one just now. Alright, the score that's before and after we had post, we show you. Graded note from students, featuring comments and feedback. So we need that if you mark your student assignment, you need to show people. Okay, if you do your supervision, I think you need to see your people from the students' graph. Okay, so that is a graded note from student, featuring comments and feedback. Other related evidence. Okay, so it can be whatever that you think appropriate for your portfolio. Alright?
About your teaching, right? You don't only, for example, the Zahir is
a civil engineer. Okay, so you don't only write about whatever research in civil engineer, okay, but you also write about how to teach students in civil engineering courses. That is the most important. Content, I guess, but how to teach people the content is one of the crucial components of the course. Okay? So we have, again, design new courses. Projects. Itulah yang salahnya, itu yang salahnya, you know, it is not wrong, but you know, when you do a curriculum, you it is not just, you know, you see the curriculum and then, you know, you just tukar, you just change a little bit of your curriculum. Usually, if you bring the curriculum with you, that is what we do. Okay, but now, you have to think on that. Alright, what new subjects are you going to offer? What innovative teaching? What, you know, what new that you do to the curriculum?
Yes.
No, it is under record mission. Record mission. Okay. So, how many times you can just go? This one. Honours award and recognition. So for me, I answer in the MBA and okay, for program evaluation. So okay, so that's why I have it in my so more funding programs like also. Yes, yes. So I said, pattern of Assoc or ICT Multimedia, I said more than 18 programs. Okay, more than 18 programs. Tapi, you have all the 18 programs there. Okay, that's everything that's really wrong. Alright. That's, yeah, also in that step. The one thing you got, right? Alright. And then whatever lah. Okay. So whatever you would like to highlight,
Thank you.
especially on the key, but you can also do the research. Okay? And the assistant is the key man. Okay, for example, you have to do a
Okay.
then to share the video, the micro-teaching video from the first year until their fourth year. Okay, that was not unusual, the micro-teaching, but I just want them to do that. Okay, so that they have a very comprehensive course. The photos, alright? Yeah, awesome.